Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Selected Essays from Freud by David Rakoff. In New England, everyone calls you Dave. I do not go outdoors. Not more than I have to. As far as I'm concerned, the whole point of living in New York City is indoors. You want greenery? Order the spinach. Paradoxically, I'm about to climb a mountain on Christmas Day with a man named Larry Davis. Larry has climbed Mount Monadnock in southwestern New Hampshire every day for the last 5+ years. I will join him on ascent number 2065. The trip up to New Hampshire will involve a tiny plane from Boston. I tear my medicine cabinet apart like Billie Holiday and still only uncover one Xanax. The hiking boots the Outdoor Adventure magazine sent me to buy, large, ungainly, potato-like things that I have been trying to break in for the past 4 days, cut into my feet and draw blood as if they were lined with cheese graters. I have come to hate these timberlands with a fervor I usually reserve for people. Just think, the shoes I wouldn't be caught dead in might actually turn out to be the shoes I am caught dead in. I tell everyone about the trip, my voice sing-songy with counterphobic false bravado. Guess what idiotic thing I'm doing this Christmas. I'm like Cloris Leachman in Kiss Me Deadly, trying to ward off her certain demise by telling the astonishingly talent-free Ralph Meeker to please, please remember her. Of course, things don't work out terribly well for her, and the very next time we see her, she is being tortured to death. It bears mentioning here that Monadnock is not Everest. It is 3,000 feet high and the most climbed mountain in the world. It's not even a real mountain. So it would be freakish and abject in the extreme were I even to twist an ankle, to say nothing of actually die on Monadnock. I would probably deserve it if either came to pass. But I do not let this sway me from my worrying. I have other reasons for concern. For starters, I am only playing at reporter here. I have never been sent anywhere on someone else's dime, relying up to this point upon my relentlessly jokey, glib, runny-mouthed logorrhea, and the unwarranted good graces of magazine editors who just let me make stuff up. It takes all my strength not to call my editor and tell him that the jig is finally up, that I cannot do this piece. It seems too bad that the jig has to be up so far from my home in New York with its excitement, bright lights, and major teaching hospitals. The central drama of my life is about being a fraud, alas. That's a complete lie, really. The central drama of my life is actually about being lonely and staying thin, but fraudulence gets a fair amount of play. The connecting airline at the Boston airport has a fleet of maybe 10 planes, all of them tiny, all of them serving rural New England. On the wall by the ticket window is a season's greetings poster that is a collage of photos of the 20-odd employees. They might as well be yearbook snapshots of the wrestling team of the high school I never went to. To a man and woman, they are healthy blondes in shorts and polo shirts, jostling playfully in the pictures, posed antically on a baggage carousel. I sit, the only dark-haired person among the broad-faced butter-eaters, wondering if my outdoors journalist drag, flannel shirt, jeans, most hated boots of Satan's workshop, down jacket, is fooling anyone. Across the aisle of the waiting area, sits a 14-year-old girl, her face a somnolent mask of misery and hatred for the parents who sit nearby. Is my fakery as apparent as her anguish? She is outfitted in the teen goth uniform, black jeans held together with safety pins, a torn black tank top, a black shirt over that. She has a tattoo of a small blue tear at the corner of her right eye, which should prove very helpful at job interviews in 10 years' time. She could be a poster child for adolescent self-loathing, aside from the jarring fact that she is reading Chicken Soup for the Teenage Soul. I break off half a Xanax and place it under my tongue, and magically, the brief flight to the town of Keene in an aluminum cigar tube of a plane is reduced to nothing more than a hazy, placid glide over snow-covered piney hills. Although the Keene airport is not much bigger than a school cafeteria, and is of a similar low-ceilinged painted cinder block style, there are no fewer than 2 signs that read, "Attention! Any remarks regarding bombs, knives, firearms, and hijackings are taken seriously and they are considered a federal offense." The slightest perusal of the airfield, essentially a large parking lot filled with tiny Cessnas and the like, makes it abundantly clear that poor Keen International, I guess flights from Canada are counted, must get a lot of precisely this kind of good-natured, belittling humor. The aviation equivalent of shrieking in mock horror at a 4-year-old in a monster mask who shows up at your door demanding candy. I am disheartened to learn that the place where I will be staying is a bed and breakfast, not a hotel. My heart sinks. That means there is probably neither television nor phone in my room, and I have very little patience for what is generally labeled charming, in particular, country charm. I have an intense dislike of flowered wallpaper, ditto jam of all sorts. The former is in all too abundant evidence when I enter the inn, and the latter, I'm sure, lies in ominous wait somewhere in the cheery kitchen. There is a knotty pine bar off the entrance hall with a settee with several embroidered pillows. I'd rather be golfing. On the eighth day, God created golf. Golfers have sex in some humorous golf-related manner, etc. On the windowsill above, a ginger cat is bothering a stained glass butterfly ornament as the sunlight streams through the leaded panes. It is all I can do not to cry. The proprietress is the kind of tall, stalwart woman of a certain age that used to be called handsome. She is approximately 9 feet tall. Her jaw is a feat of architecture, her eyes blue, resolute, her faithful dog, Blue, at her side. She smiles at me warmly and introduces herself as Hannah, extending a hand the size of a frying pan. "You must be Dave," she says. In New England, everyone calls you Dave, regardless of however many times you might introduce yourself as David. I'm reminded of those fanatically religious homophobes who stand on the steps of St. Patrick's Cathedral during Gay Pride in New York, holding signs that say, "Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve." I have always wanted to go up to them and say, "Well, of course not Adam and Steve. Never Adam and Steve. It's Adam and Stephen." "You're in room 3, she continues. "Why don't you go into the dining room and have some lunch, and then we'll talk some. Come on, old blue dog." In spite of myself, I am charmed. She puts on a dark green slicker and knee-high Wellingtons and is out the door, presumably to chop the ice off the pond, deliver a calf, or raise a barn. I eat a club sandwich and drink some coffee to try to eradicate my Xanax buzz. I'm trying to appear legitimate, masculine, adult, like I deserve to be there. Somehow it comes up that the waitress is going to Kathmandu for the Peace Corps the following spring. "Nepal? Golly," I hear myself say. "Who says golly?" I think to myself. I'll tell you who. Katharine Hepburn in the Philadelphia story, and aging chorus boys in bellhop uniforms walking through hotel lobbies with huge boxes of flowers. Larry Davis stops by the inn. I introduce myself and shake his hand in a hearty, "Hail fellow, well-met" manner. In return, he gives me dispensation to climb the next day in my $20 plastic Payless shoes. I realize I have done almost no research for this trip, so I walk into downtown Jaffrey to check things out. This seems to me to smack of journalistic realness, a kind of topography as destiny new journalism Joan Didion opening, perhaps. Perhaps I should do the WPA thing, go among the folks and observe their authentic and simple ways. Or maybe I'll try on a William Holden Gregory Peck Paladin of the First Amendment type, all about the people's right to know, cracking open the festering lies of the town, controlled as it is by the despotic factory owner with the beautiful, virtuous daughter. Things were fine in this town before that writer showed up. I am, as always, overwhelmed with movie fantasies. I think of that old standby, the star build-up, where the camera wends its way through a crowded ballroom as the collectively murmured, "Where is the Contessa?" plays on the lips of all assembled. Finally, the camera stops on a woman facing the other way, her creamy nape and lush hair. "Contessa," someone says. She turns around. "It's her! Her first close-up!" "Yes," she answers, unmindful of her own compelling presence. Or the boy version, where our hero walks into town and the whispered buzz of intrigue thrills through the passers-by. Lace curtains are discreetly pulled away from windows, and everyone wonders, who is the stranger? But it is Christmas Eve.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.